And we are continuing on through chapter 9 of 1 Corinthians this morning. If you don't have a Bible, I encourage you, use your phone and Google 1 Corinthians chapter 9. We're going to pick up in verse 19 this morning. We don't want you to be lost. We want you to follow along. And we want the Lord to speak to you. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, we're going to begin in verse 19. It says, "For though I am free from all men, I have made myself a servant to all, that I might win the more. And to the Jews, I became a Jew, that I might win Jews. To those who are under the law, as under the law, that I might win those who are under the law." And he says in verse 21, "To those who are without the law, as without the law, not being without law toward God, but under law toward Christ, that I might win those who are without law." In verse 22, it says, "To the weak, I became weak, that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all men, that I might by all means save some. Now this I do for the gospel's sake, that I may be a partaker of it with you." Will you pray with me? Father, we thank you, Lord, for your word. Lord, we thank you, Lord, that we can come. We can come and we can set our minds on your word, Lord. And it can be a safe haven for us, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for the work of the word of God, Lord, and how the Holy Spirit transforms us and makes us more like you, Jesus. So, Lord, we ask, Lord, that you would help us surrender to you this morning, God. By the power of your Holy Spirit, Lord, we pray that you would make us more like you, Jesus. Lord God, in the day in which we live, Lord, put a passion within our heart to share the gospel, share the message of salvation to the lost, Lord. We love you, Jesus. We thank you. In your name we pray. Amen. As you remember, we have been studying through 1 Corinthians chapters 8 and 9, and we have found that there are either two small groups or even perhaps a congregational debate of a gray area within the church. And it wasn't necessarily a debate that we might have in the modern day church of whether we could listen to country music or not, or whether we have drums and electric guitar in church, or some of those debates that enter the modern day church. It was more of a debate that was familiar to the day in which they were living. And the debate was this: do we eat food that is sacrificed to idols? Because of this day, there was oftentimes they would take their food and they would bring it to a temple because they believed that the demons of that day could attach themselves to food. And then when you ate the food, that's how you became demon possessed. So what they would do is they would take their food and they would sacrifice it to all these different idols in the temple. And then the priest would get a portion of the meat. And if he had too much meat, what he would do is he would turn around and he would sell it within the butcher shop of this pagan temple. And it was oftentimes sold at a fraction of the price. So what was taking place was some of the Corinthian Christians of that day were saying, "We want to go and we want to buy the cheaper meat." And then there was another group in that church that seemed like they were a little bit more superstitious, even legalistic, and said, "No, that food's been sacrificed to idols." And the other group said, "Man, we're free in Christ. We can do these things." And while Paul addressed this particular Corinthian issue, and he agreed that the idols were nothing, and they did not have, and that they did have freedom in Christ, Paul gives a lengthy warning to the Christians not to use their liberty to stumble believers, nor to puncture holes in their testimony of the gospel, as we saw in the last week. And you remember we studied more in depth last week of Paul's personal example of him laying down his liberty and he's telling the Corinthian church, he says, "Listen, I have the right to take financial contribution from your church. He said, but I laid that right down in order that I could share the gospel with you. And you remember that, well, we're going to kind of go into it this week, but Paul gave three reasons that he explains why he had refused support from the Corinthian church. And last week we saw one of them, and it was for the sake of the gospel. He goes back in verse 16, if you have your Bible. He says, for I preach the gospel, and I have nothing to boast of. For necessity is laid up upon me. Yes, woe is me if I do not preach the gospel. Now, that was the first reason. It was for the sake of the gospel that he laid down his liberty or his right to take financial contribution from this church. The second reason, we turn to verse 19, and it was for the sinner's sake. Notice in verse 19, he says, for though I am free of all men, I have made myself a servant of all, that I might win the more. Paul was free to do what he wanted, but bringing people to Jesus was more important to him than using his freedom selfishly. And notice in verse 19 what he says, what he desired to use his freedom for. He says in verse 19, I have made myself a servant to all. Now, that word servant is a very unique word. If you have been studying your Bibles, and oftentimes you know that within the Greek language, Paul would use a word for servant or bondslave. It was called doulos. So what he's saying here, he's saying, listen, I am a doulos of all. And a doulos was very interesting. It was a slave that was oftentimes bought out of the slave market, and then the master would take them and set them free. And oftentimes what a doulos would do in return was go back to the master and say, hey, listen, I'm dedicating my life to service towards you. And essentially, Paul's saying, listen, I'm a picture of that. I've been bought out of the slave market of sin. Jesus paid the price for my sin, and I'm going back and I'm going to serve my master, Jesus Christ. Even though I am free, he says, I'm going back and I'm going to serve my King, the Lord. I read a story this last week of an army sergeant who was extremely mean. And there was one occasion where he had come in from a hike, so to speak, and he had come in and his boots were extremely muddy, and he saw one of the soldiers underneath him in rank. He was a private, and he was bent down by his bedside praying. And the sergeant was cruel, and he took off his muddy boots and he flung them at the man that was praying, hit him in the head, and the man seemed to be just kind of not even shaken by the fact that he had been hit in the head with these muddy boots. The sergeant kind of laughed it off, went to bed, and the next morning, he found his muddied boots had been polished and laid neatly beside his bed. And that sergeant went on to say that that act of kind service on behalf of the soldier resulted and my salvation. One of the questions that I think about when I heard that story is, how do I view the lost? Do I view the lost as the enemy that is to be fought with, or are they somebody that I can serve? In the latter, how am I serving them? Do I look for opportunity to serve my neighbor? Do I look for opportunity to serve the lost family members in my life? If an unbeliever is rude to me, here's one thing that challenged me. If an unbeliever is rude toward me, how do I react? Do I react with anger, or do I react with kindness? It's challenging, isn't it, to react with kindness and service in that way. And Paul says that we should use our freedom to serve others, even the lost. Now, Paul goes on to describe two different types of people that he was serving. He tells us, first of all, in verse 20, he was serving the Jewish people. He says, to the Jews, I became a Jew, that I might win the Jews. To those who are under the law, as under the law, that I might win those who are under the law. Paul essentially took on some of the Jewish customs, even though he knew he was free and he didn't have to. You remember back into Acts chapter 18, there was an occasion where Paul went on and he took the Nazarite vow. If you're familiar with the Nazarite vow, they would have three different things primarily that they wouldn't do. They would not drink any wine or any fermented drinks. They wouldn't eat any grapes, or they wouldn't eat any raisins, nor even the seeds or the skins. And another thing that they would do is they wouldn't cut their hair, and they would let it grow for the length of the vow. And then the third thing was that they wouldn't touch anything that was dead. They would just, they'd leave it alone. But Paul said, listen, I knew I'm free. I have freedom in Christ, but I'm putting that aside so that I might win those who are Jewish. On another occasion in Acts chapter 21, Paul participated in the Jewish purification ceremonies, which he knew were not necessary for his own life, but he hoped it would build a bridge of ministry to the Jewish people. And these were things that Paul was willing to do to win the lost in the Jewish people. And you notice also in verse 21, there was also another group that he served, the Gentiles. He says in verse 21, to those who are without the law, as without the law, not being without the law toward God, but under law toward Christ, that I might win those who are without the law. In other words, to the Gentiles, he behaved himself as if he himself had been a Gentile, that is, forbearing the observances of the Levitical law to which the Gentiles had never any obligation whatsoever. You remember in Acts chapter 17, when Paul went to Athens and he went to preach the gospel, it says that they took him to Mars Hill. And when he was there at Mars Hill, they came to Paul and they said, hey, we want to know more of this new doctrine. What's this new teaching that you're trying to teach us? And it says that they brought him to Mars Hill, and they said, we want to hear more about this. And then Paul, when he stands up in the midst of Mars Hill, he says, men and brethren, he says, I perceive that you are very religious. And he goes on and he says, for I was passing through and I was considering all your objects of worship, and I found an altar. He says, I even found an altar that said to the unknown God. And he says, let me tell you about this unknown God. He says, you have so many gods. You have a God for this. You have a God for that. You even have a God for gods you don't know about. Let me tell you about the unknown God, the one and true God. He says, in him, all things consist. He was the creator of the heavens and the earth. He says, this is the God. And he says, he's not to be worshiped with men's hands as though he needed anything. He says, he gives life and breath in all things. And Paul essentially preached a message that they could plainly understand. Friends, the world in which we live in, the city of Edmonton, the province of Alberta, Canada, it needs a message that they can plainly understand. They need the gospel message. They need Jesus Christ and him crucified. It's not the messages of this or that, of how the moral gospel or whatever it may be. Listen, it's Jesus Christ and him crucified. That's the only message. That's the message that people can come and they can receive salvation and have eternity with God in heavenly places for all of eternity. And that's the only message. It's Jesus Christ and him crucified. That's it. That's the beauty of it. And listen, one of the things that we can do, and you know, I was thinking about it the other day when Paul went to Athens. He looked around and he saw all the things that was troubling him. He said, man, they got a God for this, they got a God for that. And he says, they even got a God for the unknown God. And I was thinking about, you know, what is a message? I was just, Lord, put something on my heart. I just give me a message for the world in which we're living in. One of the things I was thinking about, and this is just me personally, this is just I felt like the Lord laid upon my heart. We live in a city, in a province, and in a country that has craved strong leadership. Don't you agree? Like we want someone to lead us. We want someone to lead us in our city. We don't want someone that is gonna take half the time off and get a secondary mayor when he's not in. We just want someone that's gonna take control and lead us. We want someone provincially that's going to lead us. We want someone that's as a prime minister that's going to lead us. We want somebody. And listen, here's the answer. If you ever hear someone complain about the government, here's what we can do. The Bible says in Isaiah chapter 9, for unto us a child is given. For unto us a son is born. And you remember what it goes on and it says after that, it says the government will be upon his shoulders and his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. And listen to this. It says, of the increase of his government and peace, listen, friend, there is no end. And upon the throne of David and over his kingdom, he's going to rule and he will establish and he will have judgment and justice from that time forward forever. Not for a period of time, not for 4 years or whatever his term. Listen, Jesus is going to rule and reign forever. And the Bible says that of his government, there will be an increase of justice, of peace. Isn't this what our culture is craving? Justice and peace within the world in which we're living? Listen, here's the answer. Jesus Christ and him crucified. If you want to see that and you want to see the government that's going to have increase in peace and justice, you need to accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior. That's the only answer. And that's it. And listen, Jesus promised that it is coming and it will come. After the 7-year tribulation period, when we are in heaven with Jesus for 7 years, that kingdom will be established. Jesus promised, and we will be there forever with our Lord. Now, the ultimate principle that Paul is trying to convey, I read a quote from Pastor Chuck Smith. If you saw that, if you saw the Jesus Revolution, it made it even more powerful. Paul sought to win people to Jesus Christ by being sensitive to their needs and identifying with them. And he said, we should try to reach people where they are at today and expect to see changes at a later date. Friends, let's preach the gospel. Amen? Amen. Now, notice in verse 22, he says, to the weak, I became as weak, that I might win the weak. And he says, I have become all things to all men, that I might win, that I might by all means save some. Now, when reading this verse, there are oftentimes two misconceptions that revolve around verse 22. For example, when Paul says, I have become all things to all men, one of the misconceptions that people have about Paul's life is he is a chameleon. He doesn't have a backbone for truth. But we should not think of Paul. He did not change his doctrine nor his message to appeal to different groups. You remember at the beginning of this letter, Paul would write to the Corinthians, and he said in chapter 1 that the Jews request a sign, and he says the Greeks seek after wisdom. He says, but ultimately, we preach Christ crucified. That's it. It's Jesus Christ and him crucified. And that message does not change. Now, secondly, another misconception, and a lot of times people will quote this verse in saying that it gives them a license to walk in sin or walk in the lust of the flesh, essentially to be a carnal Christian. Oftentimes, this is one of the most abused verses in the Bible by people who like to justify walking in the lust of the flesh or justify living in unrepentant sin by saying, well, I'm just trying to reach them with the gospel. You know, there's been times where I've had conversation with people and they're like, yeah, I'm gonna go to the bar tonight and I'm just gonna get a little sauced and I'm gonna try to reach people with the gospel. You know, and they show up to the bar and just, do you know Jesus? You know, I just think that's not the way to reach people. It is so ineffective to try to reach someone with the gospel when someone lives in rebellion to God's word. But an effective way to reach someone with the gospel is to live a life that has been forgiven by the work of Jesus on the cross, and he submits or she submits to the will and the word of God. And I think, friends, that's one of the most powerful testimonies, is to see a life that has been changed dramatically by the power of the cross and the word of God and the Holy Spirit sanctifying the life of the believer. Listen, that's a message, that's a testimony that the world needs to see and needs to hear. It's someone who has been forgiven and cleansed by the blood of Jesus Christ. The Apostle Paul would write to the Romans, and he would say, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is good and acceptable and perfect in the will of God. Now, those are two misconceptions. The correct way to view this verse would be in verse 22, where Paul says, to the weak, I became weak. Notice he doesn't say, to the sinner, I became a sinner. I walked back in that. He doesn't say that. He says, to the weak, I became weak that I might win the weak. You know, over the years, scholars have debated for years who the weak ones that Paul is speaking of here in this verse. It seems that in context, he would refer to those that were weak that he described in the previous chapter, who were caught up in the superstitions and the legalism and essentially in their weak understanding. But rather than spend time arguing about who the weak person was that Paul was referring to, I think the more important question is for us is who we need to ask ourselves, we need to ask the Holy Spirit, Lord, who is the person in our life that is weak, that we can become weak for, and that we can share the gospel with? Who is it that you've placed in our life? What coworker, what friend, what family member is weak in their faith or weak in their understanding about who God is and needs to place their faith in Jesus Christ? And we need to ask the Holy Spirit, Lord, how do you want us to reach them with the gospel? How would you appoint an open door that we could walk through to share the gospel with that individual? Let's ask the Lord to do that this week as we go about our week. Now, as we continue on in verse 24, it says, do you not know that those who run the race all run, but one receives the prize? He says, run in such a way that you may obtain it. And everyone who competes for the prize is temperate in all things. Now, they do it to obtain a perishable crown. He says, but we for an imperishable crown. And he says, therefore I run thus, not with uncertainty, but I fight, not as one who beats the air. He says, but I discipline my body and I bring it into subjection. He says, lest when I have preached to others, I myself should become disqualified. The third reason that Paul had refused to take support from the Corinthian church was for his own sake in verse 24. He says, do you not know that all those who run the race or run in the race, he says, all run, but one receives the prize. And Paul says, run in such a way that you may obtain it. Of this day, the sporting events in Corinth was extremely popular. And it was especially meaningful to the Corinthians because of this day they had the Olympian Games, which was the pinnacle of sports in the ancient world of this area and this kind of this time frame. But in Corinth, the second most popular was the Isthmian Games. And it was actually held within Corinth. And one of the things that was extremely popular, especially when Paul recognized that it was popular, because he used this figure in these games or the athletics on at least 12 different occasions in his letters, speaking of chariot races, gladiators, runners, boxers, trophies, and so forth. Now, you notice in verse 25, he says, and everyone who competes for the prize is temperate in all things. Now, they do it to obtain a perishable crown, but we for an imperishable crown. Paul's saying to compete as an athlete, you have to be temperate. And this term refers to the manner in which the Roman athletes would oftentimes live. And to participate in many of these games, they would have to train their bodies and prepare their bodies and train for their event for 10 months to qualify for these games. And an athlete must refuse things at times that must in themselves be fine, really just nothing wrong with them, but oftentimes they will hinder the pursuit of this goal. Even so, the Corinthians were to refuse certain things that might hinder themselves, like meat being sacrificed to idols, because it would hinder the pursuit of an important goal. And you notice what that goal is in verse 25. It says to obtain a perishable crown. And Paul says, but we an imperishable crown. Now of this day, when you would win the Isthmian Games or something of that nature, you might think, well, what's the prize money? It's got to be like 100K, something like that. Maybe a little bit of gold bling you put around your neck, something like that. What about silver? You know, do they have bronze? But of this day, they really didn't have any of that. It wasn't like the modern day games where, you know, we give out participation trophies for everything in kids' sport. And that drives me nuts. I just, like, fling it. Get it out. I don't want son, we're going for a prize here, you know. I'm trying to teach my son. This is our verse, see too. Anyways, but of this day, if you were to win, you would get a perishable crown, so to speak. You would have a wreath that was oftentimes made of olive leaf or celery leaf, and they would put it upon your head. In fact, in Corinth, they would have a, it was described as a wispy pine needle crown, something that you would probably see on Pinterest or something like that, you know, it just, you know, and that's it. That was their prize. Get a little of this wispy pine crown. What you think, you know? And it would last a week. You know, they wear, oh, hey, yeah, just, it's wispy, isn't it? And I don't, that's what they did. And they were excited about it. Paul says, listen, they train that hard and they refuse certain things for something that they can wear for a week, maybe even put on their mantle for a few days. Paul says, listen, we got an imperishable crown. We got something that's waiting for us in heaven. He says, this is the reason we need to lay down some of the liberties, maybe the rights that we have. Paul says, listen, let's lay that down for the sake of the crown that is waiting the life of the believer in heaven. You may say, well, what do we do with this crown? Because when we get to heaven and we receive this crown, what are we going to do with it? Well, I'm glad you asked. In Revelation chapter 4, it says that we're going to take our crowns, and when we come before the throne of God, it says that we're going to take our crowns and we're going to cast them before the Lord. And we're going to say, Lord, you are worthy. We're going to sing you to, Lord, you are worthy to receive glory, honor, and power. For you created all things, and by your will they exist and are created. That's what we're going to do with our crown. Now, if I may make a point of application here. I was reading a story of two different runners. And on one occasion, a man by the name of Roger Bannister became the first man in history to run a mile in less than 4 minutes. And then another man, within 2 months, eclipsed that record by 1.4 seconds. So they thought, you know what? Let's have this event where we can get the two fastest runners in the world to get together, and we'll have a clash of the titans, two men that can run a mile in less than 4 minutes. So they did. They got these two guys together, and they got together for a race, and then the race was so close. At the end of the race, one of the men was haunted by the question as he neared the finish line, and he thought to himself, where is Bannister? And it says that the article goes on to say that he turned and he looked. And as he turned and looked, it says that the man, Bannister, the man's last name, he took the lead and crossed the finish line. And one of the things I think about as we look at this verse, and we have an imperishable crown waiting for us. Listen, let's not fix our eyes on the perishable things of this world. Let's fix our eyes on the imperishable. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 12, let us lay aside every weight and sin which so easily ensnares us. And it says, let us run the race with endurance, the race that is set before us. And it says, looking to Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. Friend, are you looking to the perishable things of this world to try to bring joy or trying to bring satisfaction? Listen, fix your eyes on Jesus. Jesus is the one that we need to fix our eyes on. Now notice as we go on in verse 26, it says, therefore I run thus, not with uncertainty. Now, I knew I was coming up on a passage where I was going to be speaking on something with running. So I thought to myself, well, I better go to the gym and run this year. So for the first time this year. I went to the gym and I ran, and I'm running like 25 minutes in, just nice steady jog. And I'm on the treadmill, just running at Twilliger, and somebody comes and they sit right on the bike right in front of me. And you know, they're going like, you know what I mean? Like, it's a stationary bike, but even if it was real, I don't know if they'd go anywhere. Like, it's just barely moving. And I was like, you might, you know. And then they're flipping through the channels on the TV, on the bike, and they're exercising with uncertainty. You know, there's no real, you know, motivation behind it, you know. And they're watching the Food Network, watching this lady bake a cake. And I was like, man, this is a perfect sermon illustration. Like, praise the Lord for you, you know. And then, you know, she left, and I was like, what channel was that on? I want to see the end of that cake, you know. But you understand, you know, there's people that exercise with certainty, and then there's people that exercise with uncertainty. You know, there, Paul goes on and he says, thus I fight, not as one who beats the air. In other words, he's saying, listen, I'm not shadow boxing. He says, this is the real deal. I'm not just striking the air. You know, the other night we had a family over at our house, and their kids are in Muay Thai boxing. And I was like, hey, man, show me a little something, you know? And I was like, teach me, just in case anyone ever rushes the pulpit, you know, and I'm ready, you know, that kind of thing, you know. And, you know, how old are you guys? How old are your kids? Eight and six. It's just, and there they are, just, you know, and they're showing me some stuff and just like doing it, thankfully, in the air, you know, not, you know, just not doing the real thing. I didn't have my pads on, you know, but, you know, just showing me, I was like, man, like some of those flying kicks, just, I don't want to be on the other end of that, you know? And, you know, and they're, you know, like, yeah, we're, you know, it's got to fight. I was like, tell me when he fights next. I want to see this in action, you know? And I don't want to see like the shadow box. I want to see the real deal. Like, this is getting exciting. That's what Paul's saying. He says, listen, I'm not just out here just throwing punches, acting like I'm, you know, I'm a fighter. He says, I'm in the fight. He says, I'm running with a race with certainty. And he says, I'm fighting the good fight of faith. Now, he goes on in verse 27. And he says, but I discipline my body and I bring it into subjection, lest when I have preach to others, I myself should become disqualified. The word discipline there is kind of a weak translation. In the ancient Greek, the word means to strike under the eye. And essentially it means to give a black eye. And Paul is saying, listen, I don't want my body to lord over my entire being. In other words, Paul wanted to make sure his body was the servant and the master, the inner man, was the master, the one, the spiritual one inside. And his desire was for his body not to rule over his entire self. And in context, I personally don't believe disqualified here refers to a loss of salvation, but more so the loss of a reward in context. Now, come back with me to verse 24. Let's close here. Paul says, run in such a way that you may obtain it. The word race that is in verse 24 refers to an oval area that was surrounded by tiers of seats for spectators. And it would be much like a race today. If I were to say, hey, you want to go to a race today? And you say, yeah, we'd show up. And there's two different kinds of people. There is the people that are participating in the race, and then there are the spectators. There are those who run, and there are those who don't run. This past week, I've been trying to make it a point to support the children in our children's ministry, and I've been going to a lot of the sporting events. And man, I've been having a blast. Like, I've been to a couple U11 basketball games. Been to a U13 basketball games. I went to one of the high schoolers' basketball games the other day, and I've noticed in every event, the people that are spectators, almost all of them have something to say. including me. But I was at one U11 basketball game, and I'm sitting there and just, you know, I'm quiet. You know, me and my son are watching. My son's friends are in the game, and we're just watching. We're just clapping. Yeah, get it, you know. And there's a parent who we had no idea who they were. And every once in a while, you know, when, if the team would turn the ball over or something, it started off as like a grunt, like, you know. And then it turned into a deep sigh. And then it turned into a, man, I kid you not, my son was there. He heard it. 40-year-old man said at a U11 basketball game, if I was out there, I was like, you laugh because we're the same way, aren't we? You know, we love to criticize, or we really know how it's done, you know? We could set that whole thing, just take care of business, you know? Paul's saying, hey, listen, I want you to run. He tells the church of Corinth, and I believe he would tell the church here today, the word of the Lord is good to every generation. He says, I want you to run. He says, listen, I don't want you to be a spectator, because oftentimes all spectators do is speculate. He says, listen, I want you to run. I want you to get in the race, and I want you to run the race that has been set for you. Listen, Jesus Christ has set a race before you. You may say, well, listen, I'm not a runner. Don't worry, it's a spiritual race. It's just, God has set before you a race. Listen, Ephesians chapter 2 says that we are his poema in the Greek. We are his work of art, essentially. And he has laid out good works for us in our race that we should walk in them. Listen, it's not a sprint. It's a marathon. This is a long distance run. And we're called as believers to run in that race. We're not called to sit on the sidelines and say, well, you should do that. No, we're called to jump in the race. And listen, I want to encourage you this morning. If you're not in the race, it's time to get in the race. It's time to read your Bibles. If you're not reading your Bible, it's time to get serious about prayer. It's time to get serious about serving the Lord and preaching the gospel. Let's run the race that the Lord has set before us this morning. Amen? Father, we thank you, Lord, for our time. And Lord Jesus, we thank you, Lord, that you set before us a race, Lord. And Lord, thank you that you call us. Lord, you direct us. You show us the way, Lord. And Lord, we don't have to run with uncertainty. We can run the race knowing that the finish line is heaven. Lord, thank you for giving us the promise of eternity, that we will be with you forevermore, Lord Jesus. And Lord, we look forward to that day when we cross the finish line and we hear, well done, thy good and faithful servant. Lord Jesus, we long for that day. And until then, we run. We love you, Lord. We thank you. In your name we pray. Amen.